And if you wait 5 more years, there's a bit longer list at that moment. So thank you all for being here today. I talked today about a topic that is really near to my heart. The term protect and serve is actually a joke on what you see on the police cars in Los Angeles. And so if I really think about sort of what should be your first and foremost concern or your first and foremost priority at all time when you're developing software or when you're architecting it, yeah, is to protect your customers. Yeah, and priority number two in that case should also be to protect your business. I think in a modern climate where threats are changing continuously and where there's almost no week that goes by when there is not some report of some data breach somewhere. And believe me, those are only the reports that end up in the press. I think actually that without protecting your customers, you don't have a business. And I think us as technologists, after all, this is the Dublin Tech Summit, so I assume most or all of you are technologists. I think we should take responsibility here. Not that we were responsible for the data breaches of the past, but we definitely can make ourselves responsible for protecting our customers now and in the future. Because these data breaches are only in these data attacks and state, whether it's state actors or whether it is competition or whether it's skip kiddies or whether it's government, your data is going to be extremely valuable. And I know that often as a, especially as a startup or as a young business, you don't want to think about security up front, yeah, or how to protect your customers. You really think about building your product. But believe me, without protecting your customers, it doesn't matter what kind of product you're building, you'll be out of business if you do not protect your customers. And I think things have changed dramatically. There is no line in the sand that says, this is good enough security. Yeah? If your site or your app or whatever have a stamp of ISO 20701 or whatever on it, there is no hacker that comes by and says, oh, I won't touch that. This is a line in the sand that is continuously changing. And as such, all of us need to educate ourselves about how to protect our customers. And not only in the end application, but in the whole process of developing software. And making sure that this whole new pipeline that we're building is secure, and that the products and the results of that are secure. And I think most security practices come out of the world of sort of the waterfall model, yeah, where you would develop for 6 months, and then the security team would come in and do a security review, and then you can launch your application. In a continuous integration and continuously deployment world, these things need to change radically. We need to take a very different approach there if we want to make sure that the products that we're building are really protecting our customers and thus our business. I believe that security should be everyone's job. It's no longer a security team. All of us need to take responsibility for that. Just as that we've moved from a differentiation between development and operations into a DevOps model, we all need to move to a part where we go to a dev secure ops. And we need to take all responsibility for that, because no one else is going to do it. And if we really want to protect a future society from all sorts of digital mishaps, we as technologists should take responsibility. And so, in my eyes, the security is no longer something that is a team that afterwards is always the blocker in developing your applications, but it should be a continuous process. Yeah? You need to be able to protect and serve, because you need to make sure that your business can run as well. And so, if in the past, you know, this would look like the security team of all different places, the parts that actually do the operations of security, those in interactive engineering, whether it's compliance and application security. Developers need to be in the middle of this. We need to take responsibility for this. This model of the past where the security team comes in and after sprinkles some magic over your app, in general putting a firewall around it. Yeah? Remember that if firewalls were the right protection mechanisms, our cities still would have moats. We don't. Yeah? We protect our individual houses, or even within our houses. We have different rooms or different capabilities that we protect differently. So why don't we do that in our digital systems as well, instead of relying on these firewalls? If you look at most of the threat information, you will see that there are very little brute force front door attacks. They definitely almost never succeed. However, you know, someone will send this email to all your employees saying, this is your new retirement package. Click this link and sign this document. There is always an idiot that clicks that link. And if that happens, some evil JavaScript gets downloaded, tunnel gets established, and if then your individual systems within your firewall are not individually protected, you're toast. And also, if you look at many of the threats from the past, you will see that social engineering plays an extremely important role there. And so, in all of this, I believe automation plays the most important role. As we've seen with other major capabilities, whether it's how to scale things, how to make them reliable, if you can take humans out of the loop, you can reach the levels of efficiency and reliability that you're really looking for. And so with security, we need to continuously innovate and build new automation tools such that we can take humans out of the loop in the first place. Because only then can we really start, continue to move fast, not only protect, but also serve the applications that we're looking for. And so if you look at sort of why, I think that's obvious. You know, we need to protect our customers. Who needs to do that? We. Yeah, as developers, as architects, we need to be the ones that take responsibility for this. Now, what are the places where this needs to happen? And I think in the first place, you need to look at the continuous integration and continuous deployment pipeline, because that one by itself needs to be secure. Yeah, you need to have hardened developer services or roles in that. You have to have clear definitions of those. And also then, the actions that you take place in the continuous integration and deployment pipeline need to be secured by itself. So let's take a look at that. Yeah, on one end, we have indeed access roles. The other one, artifact validation. If this is a traditional CI/CD pipeline, yeah, where you have your version control, you push things in there, you get a GET, your continuous integration server will pull things up, you'll build your packages, deploy it to whatever the staging you need to do. And so this is your traditional pipeline. We need to add things to that such that, you know, for example, you can have automated checks on whether or not you're pushing your credentials into Git. The number of times that we found developers pushing their AWS credentials in their source code, in public, in GitHub, yeah, you won't believe how often that happens. Fortunately, we, together with Git, try to protect customers there, but these are sort of obvious steps that you should do yourself. Yeah, if you add new libraries to your application, that should set off alarms, because you need to actually know, why are these new libraries being added? Was this by design? Was it some sort of insertion mechanism from something else? Yeah, so this whole pipeline needs to have multiple steps in it, where in an automated fashion, you can check the kind of steps, the kind of potential risks that you're running. So if you think about sort of best practices around there, first and foremost, infrastructure as code is absolutely important. Yeah, and because if infrastructure becomes code, these are steps that you can then, changes to your infrastructure are things that you can validate. Because suddenly, they're documents. instead of someone just typing in some commands from somewhere to start your servers or to change sort of the way that you're accessing your databases. Yeah, so I think really that's part of it, using tagging, be able to have your infrastructure be immutable, making sure that there's different versions so that you can check how your infrastructure is changing over time. And if you look at sort of these things, when should you be doing this? Yeah, so there's different steps, but you should be testing changes to your infrastructure, changing to your code all the time. Now, the one big fortunate side effect of doing continuous integration deployment is that probably your changes to code are going to be minimal. And it's much easier to do validation on 5 lines of code than on 50,000 or 250,000 lines of code. Yeah, so the chances that you catch, you know, accidentally introducing vulnerabilities or adding new libraries or things like that that have vulnerabilities in known vulnerabilities in them is actually pretty big. So whenever and a pre-event here is like is a push into Git to push your code into or to push it into the pipeline by itself. So when should you be doing this? Well, whenever you do a push, you know your Git hook should be triggered. And you should do code validation on the kind of things that are being pushed. Or look whether your credentials are in there. All these different steps are responsible there. And if changes happen that sort of your automation code, automation check code can't handle, basically the deployment should be stopped. And you should be able to act on that and be able to review and figure out why your tests are failing there. And after you've pushed, you know, any changes that have been made in your code to whether it's identity and access management or firewalls or security groups, all those kind of changes, if changes are being made, should trigger alarms that require a human review of why those changes have happened. And some of these things you can do in an automated fashion without having humans in the loop. But sometimes, especially when major configuration changes happen, when IAM changes happen, when your protection and your encryption keys are being changed, that should trigger a human review at that moment. Because these are major steps that require security checking. Yeah, and whether you make changes to your APIs, you have your event logs that you need to that you can trigger things off. And whether you do that on a daily basis as well, or whenever frameworks change, it doesn't only need to be whenever you do a push, but it can be really sort of on a cron level. Let's do a daily check of all the code that we've checked in today and see whether we're still protecting our customers the way that we want to. Now, I believe automation plays an incredible important role there. And at AWS, the cloud division of Amazon, we've been working really hard to give you those tools that you can use to protect your customers in an automated fashion. Now, a number of these tools come for free. Use them, yeah, because that's why they're there. And so if you look at sort of some of those that I want to touch on, there's a whole range of them, from auditing to inspection of your code for vulnerabilities, whether it's making changes to your infrastructure and testing those and making sure that rules that you set for your interfaces or for your infrastructure changes are being met. So let's take a look at some of those. So Trusted Advisor is a tool you get for free that basically tests your environment on a number of cases. It's all about cost and it's about reliability, but definitely security is really important. Yeah, and when you run Trusted Advisor, you get a report on things that are just known potential security risks. And whether those are open ports or access that you've accidentally left open, or whether or not you indeed are executing all your auditing capabilities, whether you're using multi-factor authentication, things like that. Just common sense steps to warn you about that you should be reviewing these. At AWS, we also created something called the a best practices framework. And in that, you have one of the documents in there is that of security, and basically asks you the sort of 80 to 100 different questions that you should be able to answer about your system. Yeah, and of course, I think these are questions that you should be able to answer anyway, whether you're running in the cloud or not. And so the well-architected framework also gives you the answers for AWS, but in essence, you should be able to answer these questions for yourself. Yeah, are we doing key rotation? How often do we do key rotations? Who generates the new keys? What are the security, the certificate managers that we'll be using there? And so all these questions are things that you should be able to answer yourself, make use of these public documents and these well-architected framework mechanisms that we give you to test your code. Inspector is one of these other tools that is extremely powerful. And basically, I think this is one of the more important tools, because especially if you're subject to compliance, how do you know if you do 10 to 20 code updates a day whether you still are in compliance? Yeah, for example, if you need to be PCI compliant because you're processing credit cards, you need to be able to make sure that with every code change that you're making, you're still in compliance with PCI. And of course, this tool makes it very easy because it doesn't only sort of test for your particular compliance scenarios, but also for just common vulnerabilities. Yeah, that you may have introduced in your code or in your systems. An inspector will continuously inspect your environment for whether you have introduced new vulnerabilities or whether you still are in compliance with that. And especially when it comes to, let's say, more traditional systems that run in virtual machines or on servers instead of, let's say, in container or serverless environments, those environments often get updated by patching instead of having immutable units of code. And so in those situations, using Inspector is very important to see whether the patching actually is correct over all of your systems. AWS Config is one of these other powerful tools that you can be using, because it will actually look at sort of your set of resources and let you audit all the changes to the resources, but also let you set rules. Yeah, so AWS Config rules, first of all, make snapshots of your environment and of your infrastructure every time that you make changes, but also it can set a set of rules. For example, every virtual machine that gets started and that needs to mount a disk, that disks need to be encrypted. And if there is no encrypted disk, or you launch it with a different root disk, the launch should fail. Yeah? All of these kind of rules are easy to implement and are also easy to automate. If you aren't enabling CloudTrail, which is our auditing capabilities, yeah, you're really missing out on protecting your customers. So CloudTrail logs every access to every object, to every API, and pushes that in log streams towards Amazon S3, the storage servers, in which you can use CloudWatch and other alarming mechanisms to look for anomalies. And if you have a substantial environment running, this is a massive data stream that you get access to. Make sure that you make use of the automated facilities to actually process those log streams and look for anomalies and alarm on those anomalies that should not be happening. In all of this, I think, given these enormous data streams that are being created, and not only by AWS, but also by our customers themselves, because the data sets are getting larger and larger, you do mergers with other companies, and suddenly all these data sets get combined, it is important to start making use of machine learning tools to access and to process this data to look for common vulnerabilities. And MACI is one of those. Yeah, so if you look at this data, customers have data in so many different silos. And can we make sure that sort of those who can access those silos, the different silos, are actually consistent over all of that? And especially when it comes to sort of understanding data First of all, you need to be able to process this data as automated tools, understanding what kind of data sets your customers have, and then start understanding how are my customers normally accessing this data. And so you make use of machine learning there, on one hand, to really start looking for what is the different types of data and the different types of access patterns towards the data that these customers have. The challenge there is that you cannot create one generic model, because every customer is different. And every customer has different access patterns. And that's why machine learning is so powerful in this particular scenario, because you can run it for a while, understand what kind of data customers have, what are the normal access patterns, and then alarm when you see violations of those normal access patterns. And so it's really important to understand sort of what is the baseline normal behavior, and then find what are the anomalies that you may see there. And so, for example, this is one of those cases where, you know, this may be sort of the stable access pattern that you normally see. There's a bit of a variation in all of that. And often when you see attacks happening, there may be pen testing by the bad guys sort of days before this. And those pen tests are actually things that you can detect, and so you can be sort of be prepared for a level 7 attack that you may be so seeing coming down the road. Yeah, so in all of this, do feature extraction of the data that you have, and then map that into time series about how this data is normally accessed, and then look for anomalies over that to make sure that you get alarms on things that are outside of the norm. And for most of these content classifications, there are a number of ones that actually have very high priority, especially when it comes to, for example, personal identifiable information or personal data or crucial code changes or, you know, your certificates, your keys. All of those need a very high level of protection, and you need to continuously monitor to see who is accessing those that data and whether there is actually access that falls outside of the norm. So machine learning there is really important, because we need to be able, in an automated fashion, be able to discover this of our customers. And we routinely have customers that have data sets between petabytes and exabytes, and where for themselves it's really difficult to be able to sort of identify what normal patterns would be. Now, in all of this, I think there's one particular tool that is really crucial in all of this. And as I'm already saying, you know, encrypt like, yeah, dance like no one is watching, but encrypt like everyone is. Yeah, and encryption is the one tool that we have that can make sure that you're the only one who is deciding who has access to your data, and no one else. Now, at minimum, you need to encrypt personal identifiable information of your customers and crucial business data. But I urge you to encrypt everything. Now, why should you make exceptions for one or two types of data? Why not everything? At Amazon, the retailer, because you need to be PCI compliant, we have to encrypt something like, I think, 15% of the operations. So we just made a decision to encrypt everything. That means that our engineers can no longer make a mistake in what they should encrypt and what they shouldn't encrypt, should encrypt. And PCI audits become really simple, because nobody can make mistakes in this particular context, and you can rest assured that you're protecting your customers in the most maximum way you can. Now, it's easy enough these days, yeah, because all of these services in the cloud computing environments have encryption enabled, or at least in AWS. And so whether you let us encrypt for you for a number of scenarios, but more importantly, you can bring your own keys. Bring your own keys, and you can rest assured that you're the only one who has access to your data. Not third parties, not governments, not bad actors. Yeah, no one except you. And that's really the scenario where we need to be in. And maybe 5 years ago, we're still thinking that encryption is way too expensive. But remember, 5 years ago, we also thought that HTTPS was way too expensive. Now, every consumer service runs over HTTPS. And I think we've come to the point where the encryption tools are developer-friendly enough to be able to be used by everyone. Because really, you need to encrypt your data if you want to make sure that you're the only one who has access to this data. And then it, of course, becomes an issue of how do I manage these keys, but there's enough solutions for those as well. And in quite a few of our services, actually, we're encrypting by default. So if you use Redshift, the data warehouse service, every data block is encrypted with a random key by default. And then the set of random keys is encrypted with a master key. We can generate that master key for you, or you can bring the master key. You bring the master key, you're the only one who can unlock your data warehouse data. No one else, not us as providers, nor any other third party. Yeah, and really bring your own keys. Start thinking about how to manage your keys, start thinking about how to do key rotation, and many of these other capabilities. The same goes for certificates. Yeah, the number of breaches that I've seen by expiring certificates or certificates that are left out in the open, you know, we have a service that comes for free. It even gives you certificates for free, as in free. Yeah? Why should you not use them? And so the cool thing about these services is that we'll automatically track your certificates when they expire, when they need to be updated. The times in the past that I've run into parts of Amazon.com that were suddenly offline because we had forgotten what the expiration date on a certificate was, that happens periodically, let's put it like that. Yeah? And so make sure that you're protecting yourself in every possible way, and we give you all these tools for it. And the last tool I want to point to is in an open source library that we developed. So, you know, I really find that one of the biggest threats to modern development is, even in an open source world, is code bloat. You know, if you look at libssl, I think that's 200,000 lines of code. And we've seen enough vulnerabilities happening with libssl. So we decided to build an implementation of TLS where we could use automated reasoning tools with to prove to ourselves that with very high likelihood this is as secure as it can get. So this is a very lightweight implementation of TLS that you can pick up from GitHub, and all of our services on our side are actually running this code to manage their in-transit data encryption. So with all of that, I hope that I scared you enough today, and that the rest of the speakers are just going to make you laugh and jump for joy, but that when you come home tonight and before you fall asleep, that you really start thinking, how should I integrate security into my job? How can I take responsibility for this to make sure that both my customers are protected as well as my business? So with that, make use of those automated tools and go build security. Thank you.